don't say anything, it doesn't get them a tape.
Today is April 7th, 1997. I'm conducting an interview with Malka, Pinto. My name is Murray Schechter. The interview is taking place in Tel Aviv, Israel. The language is English. My name is Murray Schechter. Today is April 7th, 1997. I'm conducting an interview with Malka, Pinto. The interview is taking place in Tel Aviv, Israel. What's your name?
Malka Jerome Pinto.
What's your birthday?
The 21st of September, 1910.
Where were you born?
In England.
What city?
London.
Want to tell us about your family?
No, my father was a cigar maker here. And when he didn't have no more work, he went back to Holland.
Did he have any brothers, sisters?
Yes. He had brothers and sisters.
How many?
Now, three died, and two brothers died in Holland in a concentration, and two sisters.
And your mother, where was she from?
From Amsterdam.
Could you tell us about your life when you were growing up in London?
No, I went to school till I was 11, and then went to live in Holland. And from there, they took me to the concentration camp.
What interest did you have after school?
I was dressmaking and that.
And where did you learn dressmaking?
In a big place, like in a big factory like that.
Was your family religious?
No. No.
Did you observe any Jewish holidays at home?
No, we didn't. My grandfather, he was very religious. He was 94 and they took him away.
And what year did your father go to back to Amsterdam?
I think it was 1923. I'm not quite sure what year they're in.
Where did you work as a dressmaker?
In Amsterdam.
In a factory or?
Yes.
How did you feel about moving back to Amsterdam?
No, I wasn't born there, so it was strange. Went to school and we had to sit in the passage to learn to speak Dutch. Because we couldn't, my dad and mum never spoke no Dutch in England, never. They came to England and they couldn't speak English and they learned themselves to speak English and they spoke very good. And they went back to Holland.
Want to tell us a little bit about your friends when in Amsterdam?
All in Amsterdam, yeah, all in concentration camp died.
How about your house? Do you remember your house?
We had a flat in Amsterdam and my father had a nice big cigar and cigarette shop in Amsterdam. He went to work that morning and he never came home no more.
Did you experience any anti-Semitism when you were growing up?
No, didn't.
So your friends were Dutch, were they mostly Jewish or
not? No, mix.
When did your life begin to change?
When I was after the war?
No, before the war.
I just went about, the, you know, the holidays and that.
When did you learn about the rise of the Nazis?
We'd never heard of it, but all of a sudden it started at once. Well, my brother in California, he was on the street and the Nazis took a lot of young men in a row and they all stand up and say, and my brother was blonde, and so they didn't take him then. All the others got shot on the square there.
What year was it when the Nazis came to Amsterdam? Do you remember?
It started in 1994, I think it was, yeah. My father left, they got him in at the end of 1941. And we got 1942.
What was your life like when the Germans came?
No, we were frightened to go on the street, and we had to wear the stars. Couldn't go on the street without a star. That we couldn't do. Right? And that every garment had to put a star.
Were you able to work?
Yes. But I could have kept it if I wanted to. I didn't want to because I was a first-class dressmaker, and I said, no, where my parents are, I go. And my brother is still alive. He was in the same concentration camp. He'd been underground for a month. He couldn't stick it no more, thus he gave himself up with his wife. He said, I couldn't stand it. The family go, I might as well go.
Was there any chance of leaving Amsterdam before?
Pardon?
Was there any chance of escaping from Amsterdam for you?
My father wanted to go on the boat, and we were too late. That's how it started.
How were your relations with your non-Jewish friends when the Germans came?
We were all right with a lot of them. Never noticed anything. Our neighbour, yes, downstairs, we thought. But otherwise, they were all right.
And what about the neighbor downstairs? What happened?
No, you could hear on her speaking that she didn't like the Jews much like that. Well, we never interfered with it. It was quiet. And my father had a milkman. He had a shop in Holland. And my father, when he knew he gave the milkman money. And he was ever so good. When we were in Westenbach, every week regular, he sent a parcel up, the money that my dad left behind. Every week. And when we came back, all our clothes were all saved by that milkman. And he was a very good man, and his wife.
Do you remember when the deportation started?
No, I can't remember exactly now. My mother and my sister, that's her mother, we had our bags packed because we knew we were going to go.
How did you know?
No, my father was gone good months before we went, and they told us all best to be prepared, you take a bag, and we went to a theatre in Amsterdam, and we all the Jews, we had to sit there. The cars came on the list to take us to Westenbrook.
Did you know where your father had gone?
No. Only he didn't come home no more. They didn't tell us which part. And now that theatre, which never been a theatre no more, is a memory with a light burning in there, where all the Jews were sitting waiting to go away.
Where did they tell you that you were going?
They told us we're going to the Dutch concentration camp. I was there for a month, I think, with my sister and my brother and a sister-in-law.
What did you take with you?
No, a set of clothes, nothing else you could take with.
What was the name of the Dutch camp?
Westenbach.
Where was it?
In Amsterdam. Probably a bit outside.
How did you get there?
They took us from the theatre with charabancs of with cars and that.
How many people were with you?
When we went, coach full. It was a big place.
Can you describe it?
Yes, we had three beds on top of each other. And we had our food, and it wasn't bad there. We'd done a bit of work there. I worked in the hospital, sweeping the floor and all that. But they didn't do nothing there to us. Only when they called us up to go away, that's when it started.
Who was in charge there?
Well, I couldn't remember that.
Were the Germans or Dutch?
No, I think the German and Dutch mixed.
When did you leave there?
In 1942.
How long had you been there?
About a month.
And where did you go?
To Bergen-Belsen.
How did you get there?
With a train of dogs in there and everything. You know, all the Nazi with the dogs that you couldn't run away with nothing. And we got in the car to Bergen-Belsen.
How many people were in the car with you?
Oh, lots. There were Russians as well who weren't there in the, and Germans as well in the Bergen-Belsen. And we wasn't allowed out. Our breakfast was just...
Can you describe what it was like on the train going to Bergen-Belsen?
No, we didn't know where we were going. They didn't tell us. When we got there, we knew it.
But what was it like on the train itself?
All talk, what would happen and all that, you know, where we were going, and we were just wanted to know, and we didn't. When we got there, we all had to get out of the train, and we went in these long huts, what you see on the television, and then we had to be examined, and then we had to go in Bergen-Belsen. All the ladies had to take all their clothes off, and all the Nazis had to see that we'd had it. We had a shower, all right. That's where we lived there. At the seat of the other shell.
Was there a selection when you came there?
Pardon?
Was there a selection when you came? Did they choose who would live and who would
No. Live? You just went in the barracks and you couldn't get out there. Once you was in, you was locked in.
What was the first thing you saw when you arrived there?
No, all these barracks and these big things, you know, spies on top in the, and the big fence that you go next came.
How many people were in your barracks?
Oh, no, I couldn't tell you much. A lot of in the barracks. And you couldn't go out to go to the loo in the evening. Just you opened the window and that's how we done it. Oh, no, it wasn't allowed out. Once we got in, we were in.
Who was with you in the barracks?
Pardon?
Who was with you in the barracks? Anyone you knew?
In the barracks? Yeah, a lot of us who was in there, yes. Although a lot of us knew there. I mean, loads of it, all the barracks are full.
Were any of your relatives there?
No, only my brother. And my sister, and me.
And where had your mother gone?
I don't know. Never know where she went. Popped to Auschwitz, I don't know. And her two children, 2 and 4, they got gassed as well.
When were you separated from them?
From my parents? My mum was in Westernborough, and one day she got called up with her. And they went in on a train, they were lucky in a train, otherwise they went in them big... and that's when I saw her go, and no more saw her. After that, I didn't know where she was.
After your shower, did they give you clothes to wear?
No, we had to wear our own clothes, and if you didn't have it, probably they would give you something.
What was the food like?
Food? Oh my God. I had a piece of bread like that. For the week, and a drop of coffee like that every day. Oh no, we had turnips and we couldn't eat them, they were too hard. Oh no, we didn't have so good food, hardly no food.
Can
we had to go to the barracks to do the food for the German soldiers. We had to clean the potatoes and carrots, and we didn't get nothing.
Were you given a number?
No. And then sometimes sat out, and when it was raining outside in the wet all the time, and after nearly all day, and then we could go back in our barracks.
How many slept together in one bed?
We three on top of each other, like one, two, three. That's how it was.
But you had a bed to yourself?
Yeah. We had a little fire in the place, but nothing else.
Who was in charge?
Oh, I don't know the names. There were so many in charge, I don't know.
Were there any prisoners who were in charge at all?
No. Oh, no, only the Nazis in charge of us, and the girls, Nazi girls in charge of us, otherwise nobody.
What kind of work did you do there?
We had to go in these kitchens to get the potatoes and the food ready for the Nazis, for the SS. Otherwise, no other jobs we got. And the men, when it was raining, they had to dig all the ground up. That's all they were doing, ground up. And when they dig it up, they had to put it back again. What they took out, they had to put back again. Otherwise, no.
Could you describe what your day like, your daily routine?
No, in the barracks nearly all the time. It was time to go back to our place. Then we sat with this one talking to you. You had to talk.
What did you talk about after work?
Could we talk? You'd got to be careful what you were saying. Because there was one German woman, we didn't know to after the war that she was a spy for the Nazis. That you had to be careful what you were saying. Because when we went to Lebanon to the convent, she went with me, they knew she was a spy for a German. That she had a mark on her arm, and they took her away to prison.
Did they have a roll call every morning?
Pardon?
Did they have a roll call every morning? An assembly for the prisoners?
No. Just called out and then go out in the rain or in the snow when it was there. Nothing else.
How many hours a day did you work?
Oh, and we went out when it was daylight and we went back probably about 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock.
How many days a week did you work?
Every day. You didn't get no day off.
Were you close to anyone in the camp?
No, my brother and my sister and sister-in-law and some friends. Like you made friends, you knew friends who were in with us in Amsterdam when they took us away. So.
Was there anyone particular who helped you survive?
No, there was. I told you the first 60. They took away and they went to Auschwitz in the gas chamber. And a week later, another 60 got called up, and my brother, my sister-in-law, and my sister, and me, were amongst the second lot. And we're riding in the train, and we never knew where we were going, and it stopped. Because we thought we were going to the gas chamber, and the Red Cross came in, and they said, "Don't worry, you're not going there, you're going to Lebanon, to a convent."
Now, when was this?
That was about half year before the war finished. Yeah.
When we were at Bergen-Belsen, how were the relationships with among the Jewish prisoners?
All right, we never no arguments, nothing, no.
Were there non-Jewish prisoners with you?
Not in our. There were different barracks where they had Russian soldiers who they kept and Germans. They had their own barracks, not PS.
Did you know what was going on outside of the camps?
Well, when they all flew over, then you had to be quiet. And we said, "Oh, who can they be, the Germans or the British?" We never knew.
Did you get any news at all?
No. Oh, no. The news I got when we went to Lebanon. The place where we were in the place where we were all right in there, in the convent.
Were you ever sick in the camp?
I once had me throat, a bit of blood come out of my throat, and there was one soldier, and he saw it, and I was nearly fainted. He took me out. It was one of these, you've got blood vessels that broke open. And that was after that touch, where I'd never had it no more.
Did you get any medical treatment?
No. Oh, no. You wouldn't get no treatment.
Did anyone help you in the camp?
Nobody could help you. It was all locked in. There's nobody could help you. Nobody. Only I told you, once was a German soldier, very good man, a very nice looking man it was, and he gave quite a packet of cigarettes on the men. He got caught, never heard of him no more. They said he got shot because he done it.
Did you receive any food besides a piece of bread?
No, and a bit of dinner, nothing else. Nothing on your bread. You didn't get no fancy food. Oh, no. Water to enter.
Were people punished in your barracks?
Pardon?
Was anybody punished in your barracks?
What, in the barracks?
Any punishment?
No, we all the same. We had to keep in there, and only the men. We heard when we left half a year before the war, a lot of them died, and you saw on the television. Later, after the war, I saw a lot of them who died in the camp, in Bergen-Belsen, no food, just, and they didn't, and they see loads of on a heap. I saw it on the television. We were just the last lucky 60 who went to Lebanon.
But did anybody do anything to receive punishment?
No. They said they're punished enough.
Did you have any capos in your barracks?
All mixed. There was no men and women all together.
They had men and women in the same barracks?
Yes.
Do you remember any religious observance in the barracks?
No, they couldn't do it there because they came in now and again to see what she was doing and what she was talking about. Mothers, no.
When you did have a chance to talk with a friend, what would you talk about?
Well, we talked, well, hey, we would be lucky, she would get out. We didn't know. We had to wait and see if we got free of that, and we didn't. And when somebody's birthday, they sang happy birthday and all songs and that.
How did you keep track of dates?
Well, I don't know. We have no paper of nothing. We never knew what Saturday or Sunday was. We didn't get no paper.
How did you know it was their birthday?
No, we thought it was September, and they said, oh, I think it's my birthday, and that's maybe then. We made it jolly ourselves then. No, they wouldn't give you no paper to read.
No calendars.
We knew when British soldiers came over, then it was terrible. They let it out on us, and the men had to go out in the rain, and all of us had to go out. But then we knew there was more going up in the air. Otherwise, we wouldn't know.
What was your worst moment in the camp?
In a concentration camp? So everything was about thinking all that, where our parents were and all that.
Did you think you would survive?
No, we didn't think we would. One said we would survive. I said, what could you say? You couldn't get out. The doors and the windows were locked, so you couldn't get out.
Did anyone commit suicide?
No. Only a lot died from hunger. And what got a cold in the rain and in the snow all day long. That's when they're locked down. There was no guest chamber there. They punished in different ways.
Was there any beating of the prisoner?
If they didn't do what they were, they got beaten, yes.
For what would they get beaten?
For nothing. They just fancy doing it.
Did you ever get punished?
No. My sister and all my brother and sister-in-law, we said, what are we going to do? We're punished enough.
When did you leave the camp?
Well, I couldn't remember when we left.
When you left Bergen-Belsen?
I know a half year before the war. The war finished in May, didn't it?
Right.
Yeah, half a year before that time. We were just...
And where did you go?
To Libanon, in the convent place. We had food there. And we all had to keep in one room. The men in a different room, because we wasn't allowed to eat quick. The front and they upset our stomach.
Why did they take you there?
No, they just fancied that let us go there for half a year. No, it was very good there. Only the German nuns were terrible.
How did you get there?
We were in the train and the Red Cross took us. Out the train and he took us there. And we looked right around and said, "Only different, lovely."
Why did they take you to the convent? To the convent.
I don't know. The 60 got called, and that's where they finished. We were just lucky ones. Let me say that. Because I had a friend; she was in there in Bergen-Belsen, and she was at the last minute there. And when she came home, she was very ill. We were just in luck at 60.
And what was it like there in the convent?
Oh, we had the British nuns look after us, not the German nuns. They didn't talk to each other. And they used to say to us, the English nuns, "Mind, keep your locker right, otherwise the German nuns come and take your parcels away." No, the nuns were very, very good to us, the English nuns. I used to go and did nothing to do. Want to come down and see how we do to make cakes and all that? I used to go down. They were very good.
How far was it from Bergen-Belsen to the
country? It was a long way. And we used to go out for a walk. Beautiful there. With the Germans, like, and they couldn't do nothing. And we used to go in the fields and it was lovely there.
Were you still guarded by Germans?
Yes. And the German nuns, isn't it, they had to say. Now the English and the Germans never spoke to each other. They're both separate churches, the English and the Germans. And the English nuns, I couldn't speak much English, but they taught us again. Very, very good, what they'd done for us, for all us. Very good.
Was the Red Cross involved in the...
They took us there. They got us out of it. No, I told you, the first 3 weeks we wasn't allowed out, overeating yourself. And we had the doctor and nurse every day. But they said, "Oh, you're okay. You can go out to your room." And that's when we got our Red Cross parcel. Every time. Beautiful parcels. We looked mad when we saw everything in it.
Who was with you? In the 60, were your relatives?
No, my sister, my brother and sister-in-law, and friends. We were just lucky, four of us. They took the four of us. They let us keep together.
And you have no idea why?
No. But when we got to there, in Libanon, they let... It's a convent, see, and it's very strict. The men had to go to another place, a big, lovely place, not with the women. But later on, they had a place where the marriages could go together.
Was there anything particular that happened that you remember very distinctly?
No. When I was in Lippenau, was everything lovely.
Or in Bergen-Belsen?
Belsen was every day the same. Nothing happened, excited and nothing. We just got locked up and that was the finish. But they opened the door in the morning and that was it. Doing the same thing, getting their dinner ready.
When were you liberated?
A half a year before the war finished.
When were you freed from...
You mean going home to Amsterdam? Oh, they took us first... The deliberators. And then they took us in the car to take some... just to get shoes and things. And all the other Germans had to lay over the window. They were not allowed out on the street. And that door is not closed. It wasn't allowed to go on the street. They took us around and all that, and we had parties in the convent, the French soldiers. And we had a good life then. And they couldn't... and they had to keep in the house. They wasn't allowed out, the Germans or women. Just we went to places where we got clothes and shoes. And then they had parties of the night. It was a different life. And when we went home, we went first to Paris for 4 days. They gave us pocket money and stayed in a hotel and we were free to walk round about.
Who took you there?
The Red Cross of the French soldiers took us to Paris for 4 days. And we had a stayed in a hotel and that, a good life and pocket money, and we were free. After 4 days, they took us to Belgium. We stayed there, and the army came, a good army came, and that. After that, we went with the airplane to Amsterdam in an ordinary airplane where the soldiers go in, all terrible. And that's when we went to Amsterdam.
And where did you stay there?
We stayed first with friends of my father. He was a shoemaker, he was Jewish, means wife was Christian, so they didn't take her away. We stayed there for a couple of days, but it wasn't comfortable. Then they put us to, I don't know, extra. It was a big a place before the war, they called it the Jews Home for People, a nice place. They took us there and we kept there for a long time.
What did you do there?
No, I went to work, I went to dressmaking again. Because we had to get our papers ready, we wanted to come to England. And then we didn't have only that little birth certificate. So my uncle said, send it back to England, we'll give you the proper one. And we sent it and he got the proper one, the big ones, what they have now. And they sent it back to Amsterdam. Then I had to get a passport. Then we went to... I worked at a book, little things, because I had a nice job there, dressmaker. And then my sister and me went back to England. And we stayed by my cousin, lived there. And then after a time, I got to start working there as well, in England. And my sister got with her brother. And they got married there, in England. But then I had a different love for you, could do what you wanted to do. It was strange first. And my brother went, he emigrated to New Zealand. He lives now in Amsterdam. And my other brother emigrated to California, he got married again. And he went to California, and my brother who lived in New Zealand, he lives now in Amsterdam, outside Amsterdam. Well, Amsterdam is terrible now. They live in the country and that. And then we used to go there for weekends. It was a different life.
When you went back to Amsterdam, did you meet some of your old non-Jewish friends?
No, not many. A lot went to America. Load of who came back went all to America. In America, there are a lot of Dutch people, because when I went on holiday all years ago, I met a lot of them who were in the in Auschwitz and that. I met a lot of them there.
Do you think about your experiences often?
Sometimes in bed I think, oh God, play. That you had to lose your parents and all the people. It's and my brother's two children. They were so little. I got the photo for them hanging there.
When did you come to Israel?
To live? When was it, Angela? When did I come here?
2 years ago.
2 years ago.
Why do you think that you survived?
Don't know. Don't know. Just lucky, isn't it? But otherwise, all the family, most of them got a guest. None of them would come back. My grandmother was 85, my grandfather 94. And my father's brother, they were young, they had young children, and sisters had young children. None of them come back. Only my father's two brothers who kept in England, and his sister, they didn't go to Holland, they kept in England, as they were all right here in England.
Is there any story you'd like to tell of any of your experiences that you haven't told?
The experience, I've got three. When we went, when we got three, there was marvellous in Libya now. We had a party, very big party in that, and everything. We went to Paris, they treated us marvellous, gave us pocket money. And then they took us to Belgium, and they took us to Amsterdam. And then my brother, who lives now in Amsterdam, he said, "Now, I've heard Jack came back, he's mad." I said, my brother lives in California. He said, "Just don't go to the hospital. I'll go first and see if he's all right." He went there, he was right as rain. He caught TB, and he couldn't go out of the country. After 2 years, he was all right. He went to California.
Is there anything that happened in Bergen-Belsen that you can't get out of your memory?
We had all the soldiers watchers could have a bath. That's every day. And the German girls used to laugh with them soldiers. And some elderly people were ashamed, and they gave them a good idea and they had to take it all off or do again. That's how we lived.
Why do you want to tell your story?
No, you remember sometimes you're laying and you think things and you like to know what's happened, and that's it. Yeah.
Is there anything that you would like to tell, any message you would have to give to your niece, for instance?
Oh, here. I live here with my niece and I'm quite happy here with her. Quite happy here, and I know my way around here, and I can find my way anywhere. Don't have to go with me, I'll find my way. I had a cataract down on my eye here, and I go back and forwards. And if I don't know my way, I ask somebody. They always tell me, you've got to go that way, and I always listen. Oh no, I'm quite all right here.
Before the war, did you ever think that you would live in a Jewish state someday?
No, because we didn't have nobody live in a Jewish state before the war. Because, I mean, my niece wasn't born then, was she? Before the war.
Do you have any Zionist background in your family?
No. I mean, none of them were born before the, like when the war was on, nobody, they all born after the war. And then she came. My niece, she lives a long time here. I used to come every year for 6 weeks. I like it here. She was in the kibbutz, like, when she was 18, and then she came home, and she went back again, and then now she's still here. And she's got two lovely girls, that one in the army, the other one is, she's getting married in May, end of May she's getting married.
Is there anything else you'd like to add?
No, everything's all right now. Okay. I'm quite happy. I like Israel, see? I like it very much.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Now, who do we have in this picture?
It's my grandfather. And? My father. Uncle.
And what happened to them?
My grandfather died before the war, and her grandfather is still alive, is that one? Yes. It's her grandfather, he was still alive. My other one, my father, and his brother-in-law and his young brother, they were in the concentration camp.
Was this picture taken?
All long before the war.
And who's in there?
My brother's at that corner, my brother, my uncle, my aunt, my mum and dad, and my father's sister, and two little kids, I don't know who they are. And my aunt who lived here, and a brother-in-law.
How many of them survived?
Now, the ones who are dead is my dad, my brother, my dad and my mum, and they died, and there's another two aunts died in there, and one aunt lived here, and uncle died in the concentration camp.
Okay. Who's in this picture?
My mum and dad.
What were their names?
Joseph and Adelaide.
When was the picture taken?
Oh, long before the war.
And who were these two children?
That's me. That was old. I was four years old. And the little mum was, her mum was a year old.
What's her name?
Ginny.
Where was the picture taken?
That was back in London. We lived in London then.
Okay. Who is in this picture?
That little boy, Roy, is 2 years on there. How old is he now, Angela? How old is he? 1938 is done.
Where was it taken?
When did they out in? In Amsterdam, because I lived there then. And it's my mum and my sister-in-law who died in a concentration camp.
What was her name?
Ella. And another sister-in-law, her name was Esther. And an aunt, she died in the concentration. Her name's Esther. I don't know the others. My mum didn't know.
And who's the bride and groom here?
It's my brother who lives in California.
What's his name?
Jack.
And his wife?
Ella.
What happened to Ella?
Died in a concentration camp.
And who is this?
That was my sister-in-law, Ella. She died in the concentration camp. That was before the war.
Who were these children?
My brother's children died in the concentration camp. Her name was Sini, and his name was John, Johnny.
Where was the picture taken?
No, before the war, of course, before they died in a concentration camp.
Who is this?
Her name is Doris, and my brother's Jack, and the boy is Morris.
When did Jack remarry?
Forty-six, when I come to England. The second time I got married, 1946.
Is this a bar mitzvah?
Last year, we went to the bar mitzvah in California. To his son's bar mitzvah. He's now married, and he's got a son of 13. He got bar mitzvah last year.
Okay. Who is this sitting next to you?
She's my sister's daughter. And I live here with her 2 years. And she's the only one really I'm in touch with her most of the time. I'm glad how I got her.
And what's her name?
Angela.
Angela, would you like to tell us a little bit?
Oh, she's my aunt. She looked after me because my mother was very, very much more nervous than she was. My father was injured in the war. I had a brother, she looked after her Down syndrome, who died, who drowned 6 years ago. She's been very good to me all my life. She cared for me when my mother didn't have much patience, and that's why I couldn't leave her at home in England. There was no one left her. And she's come to live with me now. She became an immigrant, as long as she doesn't have to go in the army. That's it.
Thank you.
Thank you.